So this, it's a great pleasure to be back. Thanks a lot to the organizers for once more giving me an opportunity to exchange thoughts on a topic I'm trying to find out more about. This is a laid-back leopard, I think, and I am by and large a laid-back guy, I think. But don't expect a laid-back talk, because we're going to keep talking about these tough issues of science and uncertainty and politics. And this is actually a much more appropriate picture, because it shows a leopard in trouble. My wife took this one in the Kruger, and there were lions at the base of this flimsy tree. And leopards are in trouble. They're now globally red-listed as vulnerable due to a familiar range of threats. And many of the 9 subspecies are endangered or critically endangered. This map shows the approximate historic ranges of the various subspecies, and as you can see in the circles below, leopards remain in only small parts of these. Some subspecies have apparently disappeared from about 98% of their former ranges. The red parts of this map are where leopards are believed to remain. 3 subspecies occupy 97% of this, so imagine the prospects of the other 6. Despite all this, leopards have don't receive as much attention as some of the other big cats, like tigers and snow leopards and lions. Also, they're notoriously difficult to count. So in the lack of hard data results often in optimistic overestimates of their abundance. Leopards do have a good claim to being the world's most international big cat. With 83 range states, at least 40 transboundary populations, and the relevance of over 11 international wildlife treaties. And this is an overview of these global and regional treaties. As there's no time to go into all of them, I'll just briefly illustrate the relevance of a few of them and then go into a bit more detail as regards the conventional migratory species, or CMS, and CITES. Many treaties focus either on particular sites or on particular species. And in the category of site-based treaties, a good example is these transfrontier conservation area treaties for areas where leopards live. Another site-based treaty is the Ramsar Wetlands Convention. And just to illustrate the relevance of this convention to leopards, consider Zambia's 8 listed sites which receive a measure of protection under this convention and all the leopard habitat within those sites. By and large, the same goes for the World Heritage Convention. And an obvious example is Isimangaliso, where I found these leopard prints in the dunes of Cape Vidal. And this is a leopard in Europe. It's part of the still very fragile population of Persian leopards that live in the Caucasus region, so Armenia, Azerbaijan, and Georgia. And the Berne Convention on European Wildlife Conservation has played a pivotal role in the transboundary strategic planning for leopard recovery in this region. And this illustrates one of the many ways in which treaties can contribute to species conservation. As Urs Breitenmoser, who chairs the IUCN Cat Specialist Group, has put it, they like to base their strategic planning wherever possible on a mandate through international treaties, as this gives them a certain grip on the range country simply. Another treaty, which often plays this role of getting states and other stakeholders around the table, is the Convention on Migratory Species. Now, the CMS Conference of the Parties has a long tradition of flexibly interpreting the term migratory species as not only including typical migrants like the barn swallow, but also species that cross borders for the simple reason that their range overlaps various countries, like gorillas and like leopards. And leopards were added to Appendix 2 of the convention about a year ago. And this Appendix 2 regime facilitates and promotes coordinated conservation amongst range states and is basically flexible. But it does not restrict the options for sustainable use of the species. For leopards in Africa, such coordination will be developed primarily under the umbrella of the joint CITES-CMS African Carnivores Initiative that also covers lions and cheetahs and wild dogs, and is meeting right now, in fact. The potential added value of the CMS to leopards is particularly clear with regard to the vulnerable transboundary populations in Asia and in West and Central Africa. In Southern Africa, SADC and Transfrontier Conservation Area agreements already provide legal and institutional frameworks for transboundary leopard conservation. And let me take you for a moment to last year's COP, to the session where the leopard listing proposal and also lion, giraffe, and chimpanzee were on the table. Until then, listing proposals had always been adopted by consensus. But this time, a few countries blocked consensus, leading to the first votes in the history of the CMS COP. And this explains the panicked look on the faces of the people in the top right picture. That's the chairman and the people of the secretariat frantically discussing the rules of procedures. How are we going to do this voting? Anyway, four countries opposed and voted against the leopard proposal. This was Uganda, Tanzania, Zimbabwe, and South Africa. And the principal argument they forwarded was that leopards don't fall within the convention's definition of a migratory species, so taking a much more strict approach to the interpretation of the term than they themselves and other parties had done until that moment. And it would seem, though, that terminology was not the principal reason for opposition. And this is especially clear in the case of Tanzania, which at the same session was one of the proponents for listing the chimpanzee, which is not exactly known for much more migratory behavior than leopards, for instance. So it's more likely that the leopard's listing was seen as a first step towards a possible future uplisting of leopards on Appendix 1, which would raise serious questions regarding the species utilization. The remainder of my talk is going to involve CITES. So from the outset, the leopard has been listed in Appendix 1, entailing pretty serious trade restrictions subject to some exceptions. Illegal trade in leopard products remains a serious problem the world over, and as you know, Southern Africa is no exception. Legal trade under CITES is largely limited to hunting trophies and skins as part of export quotas for a number of African countries. And these have been set and regularly adjusted by the CITES COP and are currently regulated by Resolution 10.14. And this is a timeline showing how these quotas have developed since 1983. Until now, all changes shown in bold print have involved quota increases. And at its last meeting in Johannesburg, the COP asked each party involved to review whether its own quota was still set at a level which is non-detrimental. In response, two countries, Kenya and Malawi, asked for their quotas to be cancelled. Some countries did not file a report in time, but the remaining seven countries have all submitted reports asking for their current quotas to be maintained. The CITES Animals Committee and Standing Committee have both given their blessings to these requests, and it's going to be the COP that takes the ultimate decision when it meets again half a year from now. Now, Rowan Martin yesterday said that setting quotas is not rocket science, but I still gather it's like an art. It's difficult. At least it looks difficult to me. So you have to base it on the best information available, adjust it regularly, and balance two things. And that's a tricky balancing act. On the one hand, a quota must reflect a sustainable offtake. Authorities of importing countries in the system of CITES are supposed to approve all permit applications for leopard skins that are within one of the established CITES quotas. So in other words, they must be able to rely rather blindly on the quota being sustainable or non-detrimental in CITES terms. On the other hand, each quota must be set high enough to allow for the ups and downs of adaptive harvest management, bearing in mind that CITES quotas are fixed for at least 3 years. Set a quota too high and it opens the door to unsustainable offtakes. Set it too low and it will curb the potential for the positive impacts of sustainable use. Now, a hugely complicating factor in all of this is the widespread lack of robust leopard population estimates. And this leads many range states to base quotas on guesstimates and oversimplifications. The go-to principle for what to do in face of uncertainty is precaution. In the words of the Biodiversity Convention, when there is a threat of significant harm to biodiversity, lack of full scientific certainty should not be used as a reason for postponing measures to address the threat. And according to the parties to CITES and the CMS, in case of uncertainty, parties shall act in the best interest of the conservation of the species. Now, the essence of precaution is quite straightforward. It aims to prevent serious and irreversible harm to the environment by erring on the side of caution, giving nature the benefit of the doubt, and ultimately doing whatever is expected on the basis of the information available to have the best outcome. Despite this apparent simplicity, there is no other principle that is subject to so much confusion and misunderstanding as this principle. And I should know, I wrote my PhD thesis on the topic, and sometimes I still wake up screaming. Here, I just limit myself to saying, and it's, this can't be done often enough, that precaution does not, as a rule, favor strict protection over sustainable use. And precaution does not, as a rule, place the burden of proof on the proponents of use to justify that use. Precaution is fully compatible with sustainable use and with adaptive management. So finally, let's have a brief look by way of example at the report South Africa submitted to CITES. It notes an overall lack of information, but also that recent data indicate an annual 8% decline of the South African leopard population. It highlights the illegal skin trade as a major challenge and signals the conservation benefits of well-managed sport hunting. Now, recent data appear to indicate that trophy hunting quotas in the past have been set too high and the allocation system has been overhauled. From now on, hunting will not be allowed in areas where leopards are in decline or where scientifically robust data on leopard population trends are absent. Accordingly, the domestic quota for 2018 has been set at 7. And this number looks unlikely to go up very fast in the coming years. It would seem to make sense then to have a CITES quota of 20, 25, 30 or so for the next 3 years, and if things go really well, have the next COP raise the quota again. Instead, South Africa asks for their 150 quota to be maintained for reasons of flexibility. But imagine an importing authority in 2019 considering the import of a leopard trophy from South Africa with tag number 132, for instance. Obviously, it cannot blindly assume non-detriment, but the system says that it can. So why hold on to an ostensibly arbitrary quota of 150? Is it distrust, perhaps, that if you lower your quota and you need it to go back up again in future, will the CITES parties, which decide on this with a two-thirds majority and all the politics involved, will it raise it again when you need it? I took South Africa as an example, but very similar issues exist for the quotas of Mozambique and Zimbabwe and Tanzania and so on. Ethiopia, for instance, reports that 5 leopards are hunted each year, but still wishes its CITES quota of 500 to be maintained. So to summarize, either I am missing some crucial point or the system is just not working very well. Final slide. So whole sessions could be easily dedicated to each of the items on this slide. I'm just scratching the surface here, but we'll be happy to discuss them with anyone who was up for it over coffees or beers as the conference proceeds. One thing's for sure, things are not simple, as Angus Middleton already said yesterday. And then again, it might also be that Michelle Fab will fill in some of the blanks in the next presentation. Thanks for your attention.